Okay, we'll go ahead and get started. If you will type this link in red into your, I'm probably need to make that a little bigger, into your search bar. So on a scale of 1 to 10, how easy, hard would you rate that?
It's pretty easy.
I mean, once you can get to the link, it's pretty easy. So usually we don't have, the issue is you have, which we'll show you how to do this, but you have to make sure that you click on the form that looks like the real form and not the one that looks like you're creating it. Like it's the basic, this is, you're just typing the questions in. It has to be the fancy version that people are gonna see. That is the link that you have to put out there or you'll get an error message, so.
Okay.
So a few ways that you can use forms in your classroom. One of the ways that I did this, and I did last year, was my first year ever to teaching. So I did my parent contact info when they came to my room on open house night. This is how I got my contact info. So instead of shortening the website address to, I did like the QR code, and then I just printed that off. I put about 7 of them around my room. And so that way the parents could either come use my technology that I already had set up, or if they were like, I don't want to do this right now, they just snap a picture of the QR code and it would pull it up and then they could move on. And I just asked them, just please take a minute and fill it out before, you know, your child comes to school so I can have your updated information. I also did the same thing with my students on the first day. We kind of did like a little get to know you thing with it so that I can have on record like some of their likes, their dislikes, pet peeves, just, you know, certain things that you want to know about your kid. When is your birthday, first name, last name, that kind of thing. So one of the ways that we use these kind of across the campus is like a bell ringer. Students can come in and they can do some kind of short little intros to the lesson while we're doing roll and that kind of thing. Also a good exit ticket to take data from what they've learned from the day. Surveys and check-ins, we like to do like a rate yourself. How did you feel about that lesson? Did you feel sad? Did you feel, did you like it? Was it boring? What could I have done different? There's all sorts of things that you can do for kids to rate themselves. And they like that because, you know, the ones that, you know, don't like it, they like to give you the thumbs down all the time. And so, I mean, usually get 100% participation in stuff like that. So, rubrics are big. I'm strictly math this year, so I'll use them sometimes for projects. But last year I did English and math, and I used it a lot for English. I would have them grade themselves, and then I would do my own rubric for me to grade them. And it's just a good way to have a backup when they say, well, I did the same thing he did. How come he got a 90 and I got a 60? Well, here is where, you know, you can back yourself up. Also, it's good for when parents contact you and want to know why they got the grade that they did. And if the kid rated themselves the same that you did, you can say, well, even Johnny rated himself what I did. So it's a good way to interact with the parents and kind of back yourself up. Assessing reading comp. I've seen a few teachers where they have posted a special ed, and so sometimes instead of having a student read a selection, we'll have them watch it on YouTube, even like a pre-recorded person just reading the book. You can actually embed a YouTube video at the top of the form, and then they can just, from right there, they don't even have to click anywhere else, they can answer questions below it so you can assess their reading comprehension. So that's a good way to use it. And then applications, which I spelled applications wrong, sorry, for student groups. So like our STICs, the way that we had them apply to become a STIC was through a Google form. They went on Schoology and we put the little Google, shortened Google link up there, and so they clicked on that, and that's how they applied to become a STIP. So I'm trying to think if we do that for any other. Oh, we did it for student
class favorites.
Class favorites. Mm-hmm. We did it for that. So that's where all the kids went on and voted for their best smile, best dress, all that kind of stuff. So, and then Molly can tell us kind of her firsthand experience. She's had a few with Google Forms in her classes.
So for my classes, we use Google Forms a few times. One especially that was really helpful, I'm sure, for the teacher was, since we all learn a different way, she put a few options and she had us vote for which way we would want better. So options were like, would you rather do the lesson in class and have homework overnight? Or would you rather listen to the lesson at home and then get to do homework in class and ask all your questions? So it really helped because she got our input and she got the whole classes, you know, because it's hard to know what everyone wants, and the form she could look at it and say, well, majority of the class wants it this way, and so it really helped. We didn't really have forms too much with learning, mostly just surveys, because I think the teachers really like to gather information that way because it's so easy. You can just go through it. I used it for STICS when signing up. I just had to go through with names and a few questions, and it was really simple, and it's nothing hard. So it's really easy for the kids, and setting up a Google form isn't really complicated either, so thank
you. All right, thank you, ma'am. All right, so this is what it looks like in the raw, so we're going to go ahead and get started and get right in there so you guys can create one. So if you will open up your Google Drive, and so all you have to do is just type Drive into your search bar up there, and it should pull it up. If you're not logged in, you'll have to log in.
Well, it was just there a minute ago. I don't know. I have to do something. Here I go. I just did the back button. What I did.
Okay, so once you're in Drive, if you will come up, there's a big red square on the left, rectangle, on the left. And if you will click on that, it says New. And you will have to scroll down to where it says More. And then your first option on that pop-out will be Google Forms. So you can go ahead and click on that.
You can click on the one under the purple one.
And this is what it should look like. Blank. So New, the big red button, New, and then go all the way down to More and Google Forms.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so the first thing they'll ask you for is your title. What do you want to name this? So like if we were going to do a STICS application, I would just name it STICS application for 16, 17 school year, something like that. You can keep it short if you want to. The one that we did today, I just named it RISD Google Form Professional Development. So it's kind of up to you what you would like to name it. Yeah, all you have to do is just click on the words and it'll let you change it. There's no edit button or anything like that. If you would like to add a description in to kind of tell your students or your parents what you're going to be doing, or maybe give them a few directions, there's a way on here to make sure that they answer every single question or some questions over some others. You can make them mandatory, so you can just put a little note in there like, must answer all the questions to be able to submit. Anything you want to put there, you can put there. So the first part will say untitled question, and this is where you will put your question in. So if you just click on that, it should highlight it. So depending on what your objective is for this. I'll just act like I'm gonna do like my parent form. So if I wanna categorize this by last name and then first name, I'll just type in last name, or you can type in whatever you want for your subject. And then if you'll look over here to the right, it's gonna say multiple choice, but if you'll drop that arrow down, you'll see that you can actually choose different types of how people answer the question. So you can do short answer, paragraph, you can do multiple choice, you can do check boxes, you can do a drop down, linear scale, multiple choice grid, date and time. So if you've ever filled out like a, I know at the junior high we do when we have to ask for time off. And so they would have put the date and the time on there for us to, and that's what we thought when we want to request time off. So I'll show you, let's do multiple choice.
What?
I'll put that on my screen. Well, actually, I'll just show you short answer for this one. That's the last name. So for something like if you're doing names, I would just pick short answer. If I want to add another question.
If you want to make it required, then you.
Oh, yes.
Click that button down
right
there. It's required, and they can't submit until they answer that question.
Mm-hmm. So if I want to turn that on.
You see it down there at the bottom?
Yes.
Turn it on.
Yeah, and it'll just slide it over.
Can you do that on every question? Can you do that? Is it all that way?
Just on that question, so you have to do it for each question. I don't think there's a shortcut to do
it. I don't
questions.
Think so. Either.
I don't think so. I think you have to do it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so if you would like to add another question right up here, you'll see a plus sign and it'll say add question. And so if I want to do a multiple choice, let's just say what city we're born. Okay, and so my option one, I can say Waco. And then if I want to add another choice, which if you're doing multiple choice, you probably want to add another choice. You can click right below it. It says add option or add other. And so I can put Dallas. I can add another and put, oops, I would add another. And if you want to add other, it'll just say other on the choice. So add others in blue, and then it just put other in there.
How do you get the type of other?
I don't think it will let you. Yeah, I think it's just other is your only option.
But if you want to delete a choice, you'll notice off to the side there's the nexus, and you can click on that X and it deletes that choice.
I can give you a right now.
It's also really user friendly because you don't have to go back and select the edit button or anything. If you want to go back to any of the questions, you can just press on it, go back and change it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you know, it's a lot plus right there. Oh my gosh, I'll change my mind when I do something different.
Uh-huh.
So I thought I was going to have to go through like 27 steps to go back. But you can just scroll right back to the.
Yeah, and you can drag and drop them if you don't, if you're like, oh, I really don't like that order, or I changed my mind, I want their first name first, I want their last name next, then you can take it and you drag it and drop it. So if you'll get it to the point where you see the cross arrows, and you can pull it like that, and it will, you can see it will drop it to the top, and now my last name is second. So you can just, you know, you don't have to know the order you want to start out with up front. You can move them around. Okay. If you notice on your form, I asked you what grade you taught. So if you want to do something like that, you can do the check boxes, or you could do drop down. Like if you are at the junior high level, you might teach 6th and 7th grade English. So you would want to do check boxes so you can check two. Drop down, you know, for elementary school, maybe you just teach 1 grade, so you would just drop that down and it would have, you know, 1 through 4, and you would just pick one. Check boxes allows you to pick one and one option.
I would put that under your description. So like where she talked about the description up there, mm-hmm. I would put all of your words up here. Here's your word bank or whatever, and then you could put
red, blue,
whatever. And that way they could go back and look. I need to use one of these words.
And they'd have to type it in.
They have to type it in.
Would they have to spell it right?
Well, this doesn't grade it. So you would have to go back and grade it. And this is just a way for it to be delivered to you without paper, and then you go back. There are programs or extensions you can add that grades. I don't know that y'all aren't going to talk about that today.
Mm-hmm. No, I think maybe advanced. I don't know if they're going to offer another session.
But I can't think of the name of it off the top of my head, but Elizabeth might be able to tell you at the end, and then you just kind of... It's an extension that you add to it, and it goes back and grades it.
So this would gather my answers, but it wouldn't tell me if it's right or wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So I could
cut it
and print out what.
Yeah, it'll kind of look like an Excel
sheet when it's done.
Responses. So, I mean, it'll have question 4, and then it'll list everybody's answer. So, I mean, if your answer is A, you can just run down and see.
At the end, she'll show you the ones that you filled out. She'll show you what the responses look like. Because if you look at the top of your page, it says questions, and then it also says responses. So once you submit, then things will start adding up in those responses. It'll show you like 2 people have submitted, 4 people have submitted, 8 people have submitted. So at the end, after y'all look at the questions, she'll show you what it looks like after you submit it, or somebody submits it.
So, let's see. If you scroll up to the top, you'll see some options up here. The first one is color palette. And if you click on that, you can click a color to change. So, like mine just changed from purple to red. I like to go to where you see the little picture icon. And you can put your own picture in there, or you can put one that they provide. It used to be a lot easier to put your own photos in there, but since they revamped this, it has to be a certain size. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I used to go on Google and I just type in Robinson ISD and I pick up like the RR picture, and it won't let me put that in there anymore because it's too small. So I tried about 5 of them because I used to just like to put that on my form, but I'll have to get in there and mess with it and see. But I would assume you have to resize it.
The little
picture icon color palette, and then down here in the bottom right.
Okay.
So they've got lots of different themes you can choose. That one has running water. This little lady turns her pages in her book. So they're kind of cute, all the different ones they have. And then you can select it. And then it's gonna load. And if you wanna see what it's gonna look like real time, if you'll look at this eye right here, and it'll say preview, and click preview, and then you can see what it's actually gonna look like. And then it will open that up in a new window. So if you're like, oh, I don't really like that, you can just toggle back to where you're editing it right over here, and you can change it if you want. All right, so on settings, this is a really important part of this.
Yes, it is. Yes.
This could make or break your Google Form experience with your people. Who can respond to your form? It's going to automatically populate anyone in Robinson ISD when you're logged into your Robinson ISD account. If you click on that and you choose anyone, if your paper blows away in the wind and Joe Schmo finds it in the street and he takes a picture of your QR code, he can go and answer your survey 1,079 times to where you have all that data. So it depends on who you want. Now, if you're doing like a parent survey, you would want anybody because your parents aren't going to all be Robinson ISD email addresses. So I think someone figured that out the hard way, Parent Night. I don't remember who it was. But yeah, so just make sure, you know, you really think about who your audience is going to be, who's going to be using this, so that it works how you would like it to. And then automatically collect respondents' RSD username. I don't check that. And they can submit only one response. So sometimes your kids will think it's funny because they know it's going to put this all on an Excel sheet to answer 50 times so that it's all on your Excel sheet. So you kind of have to watch out. They'll start figuring this stuff out. Maybe not so much at the younger grades. I don't know, maybe.
It'll take longer.
But, yeah. So if you only want data from them one time, then you can check this box. And they'll have to log in to it, but they can only submit it one time.
For so, each email address?
Yes. Yeah.
Why would you want the automatically collect? Don't you want to know who's responding?
It just kind of depends. There are times that you want it and certain times you want it. If you have them put their names on it, then you're getting it anyway. Mm-hmm. And that's just a column in your Excel sheet you don't necessarily want to see. If you're doing something anonymously, then you don't want that to be checked there. I mean, I did at the end of the year for myself, I sent out a Google form to all my teachers and I had some questions and I said, I want you to rate me on these things and things that I need to do. Well, I did not check automatically collect their names and their email addresses because I wanted them to know that it was anonymous, that it wasn't gonna, you know, and if you had something I needed to work on, then I wanted to be able to get feedback from people without having them to stress that, you know, she thinks I'm a horrible person. So there are times that you want that and times that you don't. I mean, if I was grading something, I probably wouldn't put that on there just because I wouldn't want to see that column. Now, when I do requests for time off, which I know all of you guys are using now, that kind of came from me, sorry, because we used it here and then it kind of moved on. We do collect email addresses there. So, I mean, why, it really doesn't matter, but I mean, it's how I had it set up to start with. So,
if you don't check that and you do want their name, that has to be a question.
It has to be a question.
Yes.
Because you won't have their name if you don't do that.
Let's see.
It's also a sneaky way to get parents' email addresses.
Yeah.
So, the only two choices you can respond are anyone or
not that I'm aware of. That might be something advanced and I don't know about, but yeah.
I don't know either, but I'm wondering if you could do it in class. Once you share it with somebody, I mean, if they were really interested and they wanted to send it out to all their friends, I mean, they could do it under the Robinson ISD. And that might be the time that you want to put on there, collect their email address, because then you can go back and say, you know, you're not my student, I'm deleting you, or whatever. But, yeah.
Submit another response. So I know, like, I'll relate it back to when you do your time off. Sometimes you say, well, I know I need off a day in this month, and I know I'm going to need a day off the next month. And so after you get done doing the one for this month, I just click, it'll give them an option that says, I want to submit another response. That way you don't have to go back and refresh. I mean, it's really not that much more of a big deal to just hit refresh and start over. But they can just click on that and then it'll just start the whole form over for them. It'll give them that option. If you don't check that, it won't give them that option. You can check this to edit their response.
I've never seen that in action.
I haven't either.
I can't tell you how that works specifically.
And then see summary of responses. Summary will be visible to all form respondents.
And we don't normally check that. We usually want your information and no one else's. So once they submit, then they get to see everybody's that submitted.
Okay. All right, so if you are ready to make this thing published, since it's in Google Drive, it'll automatically save it into your drive. Now, if you keep it untitled up here, right here, you did title it here. This is what your audience is going to see. But if you want it in your drive where you can find it, then you're going to have to title it up there also. Because I know I've done that a few times where I title it on it and I forget that you have to do it twice. And then when I go to find the form, I can't find it, so then I have to type in untitled, and I have like 7 untitled forms, and then you have to go figure out which one it is.
If you just click there or double click, then it
goes
straight to your title. I mean, it puts it in there for
you. Or you could change it also if you want something like different. Like, you can change it. Okay, so if you're ready to send this thing out, or have it published, then you're gonna click on send. And it gives you a few options. You can send it to Facebook, Twitter, your Google Plus page. You could also email it. The way that I use it the most is by using a link for getting that shortened URL. It can turn it into the QR code for you also if you'd like to do that. So I click on the link. And down here it gives you an option. Did I make that on the main one? Okay, on this one. There we go. Okay, so if you'll click, I'm sorry, I just did what I told you guys not to do. You have to make sure that you're on the actual form.
Because if you don't, you give them permission to mess with your form.
Yeah. So if you'll click on that preview.
If it has those tools on there, you're in the edit mode.
Yeah.
See all of the tools are gone up there? Then that is your form.
If you go back here, there you can see them over here. And all these up here. So click on that little eyeball. And then you'll just see this one up here, which that will take you back to editing. So if you'll come up here, I know there's an easier way to, there's gotta be an easier way to do this one. But this is just how I always do it. If you'll come up here and highlight your address, and then if you will copy that, on your Chromebook, if you'll look up here in your little shortcuts, I know it looks a little overwhelming because there's a million of them. You can thank Lily for that. But if you see this little lime green one up here, and if you hover over it, it says goo.gl URL shortener.
No, I'll have that one.
If you will click on that. And it'll bring that box up and automatically generate the shortened form for code for your form. Okay, yes. There it is. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so. Oh, there it is. You have it. Okay, so.
So once you have all this, so once you send it out and the kids go in or your parents go in and do their thing and they submit, then it looks like this. This is the one that you did earlier. Let me tell you, it's been amazing for me because I send it out to all the time and I get responses, and then it looks like this when I get it back.
So see how that 12 popped up when that wasn't there before? So if I just click on this, you can see each, and you can see a summary.
So all of these people submitted a form, okay? And then this is how people answered. Then you can also, do you go to Excel or something?
Yes, it will.
Or Sheets, I guess. Yeah. It's.
This little green button up here, it says create a spreadsheet.
So it'll put it, like all Susie's answers will be in a spreadsheet. All, and that's where you would grade it. So if you click that little thing up there, then this is how you would grade it. Susie Cox said she was from the primary. I don't know what that said, grade one, because I can't read. But
she's never created, no, she hasn't before. Created a form. Yes,
no,
she's filled
yes.
one out.
So that would be the part that you would grade.
This is also really good for your kids if you're trying to make sure that they get something turned in on time or a deadline, because it time stamps it. So you're like, no, you did it. I got it right here, you know. So, yeah, that's good. Let's see. You can also, if you're done, like if you're, like how we did for sticks, you know, like, okay, the deadline's Friday to apply. After that, it's too late. So you can come to this and hit that, and it will shut it down. So even if they take a picture of it, they can't get back to it.
What does the individual look like? Because I've never seen that. Does it do the same thing as Sheets, maybe? Or is that just the form? That's just the form?
I guess so.
Oh, wait.
Click the down.
What does that look like?
Do they have their name and everything?
Oh, yeah.
Look at that.
Yes.
Oh, that's pretty cool. I haven't seen that. Sorry.
That's new. I don't know when
they
updated
stuff
this
all the time.
But the old way, we would have had to do two different sessions for creating one and then analyzing your data. It was like crazy. So they didn't have them linked. So, but this is new. They just came out with the new format for it. Okay, so you said you wanted me to go back. Someone said he kind of wanted me. You want to go back a little bit? You're good?
We just practice. Okay.
Okay.
You have to practice. And let me tell you, you'll make some really big mistakes, because I did. And then you'll go back and you'll go, oh, this is much easier to do it this way. And then you kind of you figure it out. You know, that's part of everything. Once you get in there, do it. The kids love to shoot the QR codes when he goes a lot at the junior high level. We put them up in the cafeteria. Of course, they have phones, so they can shoot it with their phone and move on. We all got the iPad. So you could put those up in all different places in your room, put the iPad, they can shoot it and do it right there.
We do like scavenger hunts where we'll do like math problems all around the room, or we'll do them in the hall, we'll put them outside or whatever. But we'll just have the QR code there. So it's like they have no idea what they're about to get. And then, you know, they'll run around and do their scavenger hunt. So, I mean, it just gets them over the hump of, I want to do this. This is boring. To, okay, now there's a little twist in it. So I'm going to do it.
Sign in
rather
than just going to your page.
I'm
going to
let you play. And while you're playing, I'm going to do the phone call. If you want to draw names for prizes, I'll let you draw out of that name. Okay. You want to draw? Okay, stay and play as long as you'd like. Do you have any other questions? Do you have any other questions about? No? Thank you very much.
Thank you.